If this does, yeah, thank you. If this doesn't, if this, if it fails again, then I'm not sure what we'll do, but we'll see in a second. Let's try. There we go. This is already looking better. Okay. That's, oh shoot. Sharing the wrong screen, but that's okay. I'll just move stuff over.
We see an Ubuntu.
Yeah. There we go. Just open up the chat to make sure I can see chat. Cool. All right. Then pardon me, I'm going to be looking over here on a different screen because I got a little messy. Today's chapter is really kind of sums up the last four chapters that we've talked about. It sums up this the object-oriented programming side of things that we've been talking about. So this will probably be pretty short, a little bit shorter than the normal. We'll probably end early. And there's going to kind of be two things that we're going to focus on. One is just to summarize the those chapters and kind of think about these different systems and when you might want to use which systems, what are the pros and cons of each. But then we're also going to briefly introduce S7, which is not into the chapters, but is, I think, a really cool thing to start thinking about the next stages of OOP systems in R. So that's what we're gonna do today. So we again just remind us everybody in case you like haven't been plugged in for all of these. We have three. We have S3, S4, and R6 are the three OOP operating systems that we've or systems that we've talked about right now, at least. And in the chapter, Hadley recommends S3 basically for most folks, and we'll kind of see some see because it's kind of the simple way of doing things. Very widely used. So that's kind of the recommendation at the moment. And he really advises against using R6 because it's, I think it's such a different kind of operating system or it's a different kind of OOP system that just doesn't mesh well with the other two and how folks usually work with R, even though it meshes really well with folks who have other kinds of OOP programming skills coming into R. They're like, that's that you might gravitate toward that.
Can I ask a
Sorry, I didn't mean to
question?
do that. Yeah, sure.
Okay, so I feel like I've asked this question like four times in this section of the book, so you can tell that I'm really not understanding this. But like I thought that S3 was object oriented, but the other ones were like functional or something. But you're
No.
now telling me that all of them are object oriented programming.
S3 is kind of like a weird mix between like it's method dispatch, so it's count as functional or it count as functional because it's
Oh, S3 is
dispatching,
functional. Oh my gosh, I
but it's
totally don't understand.
OOP in the way like it define class. But S4 is kind of similar. It's functional because it's dispatching, but it has stronger class. And then R6 is purely objected oriented programming because like it's just passing methods. Let's take a quick argument.
You think of S3 as functional?
I'm thinking in my like is
Yes.
I guess it's kind of depend of what school of computer science you came from.
Yeah, I came from
If
zero
you,
schools of computer
yeah,
science,
but
clearly.
like if you came from more functional, like let's say like people that learn closure, Haskell or whatever's, they will consider it as some kind of polymorphism where like you have one structures with class. And then you are dispatching according this class.
Yeah. And
But
that's what
R6 is creating an object and you are chaining method to that object.
Right.
So in my mind, R6 is more OOP and
Okay.
less functional, and S3 is more functional and less OOP, but it's a gradient.
Yeah, I think that's a good I think that's a good point. And in reading up in some of the S7 literature too, the way that they seem to talk about it is all four of those, including S7, are object-oriented programming systems. They actually call S3, S4, and S7 functional object-oriented OOP systems, and they call R6 an encapsulated OOP system. So that might be the way, one way to think about that is, yeah, all four of them are object oriented because it's about defining classes and doing things on objects, right? So it's object oriented in that sense. But yeah, like Olivia was saying, they vary in the scale to which they're true, I think, OOP. And that, I think that encapsulation of R6 is what folks outside of R think about, right, as OOP. But there's, it's kind of a little bit of a scale there.
And just because I have these conversations with people and I get so lost, Python is most like which of these?
Mostly Python is OOP. Because you are like chaining R6? Methods. You are chaining methods. I'm not a huge Pythonist people. But like you, like let's say like if you use Panda, for example, like you have your Panda object, then you want a summary of it. So you have like your Panda object, it's called Bob. And that Bob, it's gonna pass the summary methods. I don't know. So it's, I don't know Panda, but I assume it's a Bob dot something. And yeah, then you want to pass something to this summary. I don't know, a filter, because you just care about something. Then it's become Bob dot something dot something. And that's so chaining methods. Go ahead, Dan.
R6. Yeah. So it's more similar
to R6. R6, okay.
Yeah. Go ahead, Dan.
Thank you. I was just going to say that, like, in Python and other programming languages, you don't have many OOP systems, or at least that they're not that common. So it's just OOP. And there's only like one way to create classes and one way to create objects, and that's it. So it will be like, we cannot compare like, oh, which type of OOP are we using in other programming languages, because there's only one.
Mm-hmm. Right, because they're built to be that, like that's what they're built for, is they're built for around a particular way of.
Yes, I guess they're kind of, they're part of the programming language.
Yeah, exactly.
And R, yes, yeah, like built in.
Extra. Added on after the fact, and yeah.
But okay, like one point is like in other functional language, depend, in some of them you have multiple kind of dispatching and polymorphism. So like R in this kind is similar to other, like, I think closure has like at least 5 or 6 way of implementing like this kind of dispatching stuff and having like this kind of way. So it's, and, but yeah, this is, it's really okay, boiled down. Like usually Java, for example, like is more like build around OOP and with one way of doing it and very strong way. But I don't know. It's really depend of the design of the language. And R being more close to Lisp, S, all of that, they tend to have multiple ways of dispatching. So
great. Okay, thank you. Sorry to interrupt.
No worries. Right,
it's good to get these things clarified. I'm not, I mean, I'm still not clarified on them, but I at least have something in my head. Maybe it's might not be right. So the first thing then is compare S3 and S4, right? And so the idea, what do we want to do there? And the way that they talk about this is S3 is the super simple, really flexible system, flexible because there's basically no guardrails, right? Like there's, and it's not very well defined. So you can basically do kind of whatever you want to do, which is good and bad both. So that means it could be really good for small teams who really need flexibility kinds of things, right? Because you can do whatever you want. It's really simple and easy to learn. It's used like throughout R and CRAN. Like this is the by far the most common kind of system that's used. But sometimes you might want more constraints, and that's where it kind of can fall. So S4 on the other hand is a much more formal kind of system, a lot more constraints. Personally, I think it might have like swung the pendulum too far the other direction, from like too simple and no constraints to highly constrained. So it can be good for if you have a large project where you really want to control what folks are doing and make sure everyone's using consistent kinds of language and syntax and issues, which is why something like the bioconductor project, which I don't know a ton about that. I know we've talked about it a little bit, but that's, you know, a very large scale kind of project with, and so it you know, it helps build that so that, that lots of folks can contribute to that in particular ways. The mentions are significant upfront investment in design, which again is a, both a pro and a con, right? Because it's often usually really good to spend time in advance thinking about things and setting up structures before you just start going at it. But at the same time, if you're just ready to go and hit the ground running, it might slow you down in how you get things started off. And then the S4 is not, documentation is apparently not great. Cool.
That's a good point, like the documentation trouble. Like the absence of good documentation basically mean like you are gonna burn a bit of time on yourself, founding, not hiding bug, but hide. that's a very good point.
I find that applies to R as a language in general. Like a lot of the time I find when people are talking about, which language should I learn? You know, it's a lot more than just like how powerful is the language. It's like, what do your colleagues use? How easy is it to get tutorials and, or to learn about it? Like, you know, that kind of stuff. I think over the years, I've really kind of come to this conclusion that when you switch to a system, it's not necessarily whether or not that system is the perfect job. The right tool for the task, but like, is it the easiest tool for the task?
And documentation is definitely like, I will say, a big plus in my book.
Yeah. I've absolutely stopped using things that had poor documentation, being like, I don't care if you're powerful. I can't figure you out. So I just don't care. Anyway.
And to me, I think that's where Tidyverse and Posit came in, right? Like, back, you know, I learned R well before then, when you had to like go to the forums and stuff to find answers, and it was horrible. And the like a clear push to make to put emphasis on documentation and a consistent format of documentation. So every package, like, I just love the fact that you can go to any package in the Tidyverse and you know exactly where to look for things, and it's all, you know, and there's a big push for that. And that is huge for learning language.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
And like, as for like, if you need to find this book that was published in, I don't know, like the book that you mentioned, like you should read for S4, like you need to read that book that was published like in specific years. And like, I searched for it in Amazon, like, that's sad to be complicated. Anyway.
Well, it is. And it's, and also like, if you're having to rely on books as your source of documentation, like you're just out of date by definition, you're out of date, right? Like, This stuff is changing. Things are getting added and, you know, deprecated and stuff. And if it's a physical book, I mean, maybe it'll get you going. Like, you can get going on something like that, but that's not a way to keep up to date.
That always makes me so sad, because I do love my books. I don't buy programming books anymore.
Exactly. You know, I mean, it depends on what kinds of books, but books are something like technology that's constantly changing, especially something like the R ecosystem, where, you're new packages, you know, how many, what we get like 300 new packages go on CRAN every day or something like that. I don't know. Maybe that's too high, but you know, it's just changing so fast. Yeah. All right, so that's S3 versus S4. Now we'll do S3 versus R6, and this is where we'll get a little bit to that. So we talked about, we talked about S3, we talked about these generic functions and methods, right? Same thing with S4, but that's, R6 doesn't have the generics, the generic functions like that. They have built these encapsulated objects, and there's some pretty big kind of three key differences, and we'll go through each one of these separately, three key differences between what R6 has. One is it deals with differences in the namespace and how objects are recorded in the namespace. Two, it talks about semantic reference semantics, so basically the notion of modifying the objects. And then it talks about, there's some key differences in the chaining, which we'll get to. So first, the namespace. So in S3, again, we talked about those generic functions, and those are global objects in the global you know, the global namespace. So everybody has access to them. Everybody can, you know, work with summary print, all of those kinds of things, which is great because everybody can have access to it. But the flip side of that is you don't want to use the same names for functions that do very different kinds of things. And I thought the nice example of plot, right? Usually in R, when we see plot, we think of plotting a graph, but the word plot can mean other things, right? Like plan, like a bank heist. Plot bank heist is like planning a bank heist. So you wouldn't want to create a generic called plot that does something on an object like a bank heist object that does something completely different than plotting a graph, right? That would be really problematic and confusing. And S3 allows that. So you just want to be careful of it. R6, on the other hand, the methods are encapsulated and local inside that object. And so the nice thing about that is you can reuse words like plot that have multiple meanings in different kinds of ways because they're no longer kind of in conflict with the generics that in the global namespace that you can use. So now you can talk about bank heist $plot. And so you can define plot in this specific context that's used just in that context, and it won't get kind of confused with other uses of plot as a generic. So that's the kind of namespacing. So things, so you want to be careful in thinking about how you name things in these two different ways. Okay, next is threading state. This is still a little confusing to me. So if anybody wants to hop in and kind of clarify any of this, that would be great. But basically the idea here is if you want to both return a value and modify an object, it's a little trickier to do in S3 kinds of things. Like basically the idea is you do one or the other, but not both. And there's an example, the push pop. I don't know if folks are familiar with this kind of example much, but the notion of push just means you add a new item, a new element to a stack, which is fine. And S3 can do that, no problem, right? But the notion of a pop does two things. It both takes away the top item from the stack and returns that item that was removed. So it does both of those things, right? It modifies the object and it returns the object. So it has to return two different things. And so that's a little bit trickier to do with the S3 way, which they'll go through here. I'm not going to kind of go through that into too much detail. But it's a little bit trickier to do both of those types of things with S3, whereas with R6, it's much simpler to do that, to get both of those things done. I think if I recall from the book chapter, and maybe it wasn't even in this chapter, it might've been in the R6 chapter, Hadley basically said, you really don't want to do both of these things at the same time in general. But R6 allows you to do those things.
And just to be clear, you know, that I'm remembering things in R6, the reason this works, that it does both of those, is because it does the assignment inside the function. Is that right?
I'm going to open that up for other folks. This is, again, the part where it's a gray area for me.
Assignment in part of the function here, like the item, so for example.
Like this.
Yeah, like when you're in S3 and you do that assignment, it's not assigning to the global.
Yeah,
I think in R6 it is.
In R6, the function is designed that it can modify itself, where in S3, it unless you use the super assignment, you wouldn't. And even then, I don't think you could modify it. Yeah, actually, you could do it with the super assignment, but that would be like that way danger lies. So you wouldn't do it that way.
Yeah. You have example like that, I think, in the book that's named The Art of Air Programming. It give a very big example on how you can use the super, I don't know, is it the super assignment? What's the name of this assignment?
It's like super assignment.
But the greater assignment. And it give an example of that. And I don't know, I always found it a bit hacky. Unless you are like... I found it hacky unless you create a specific environment. Like if you have just two environments, which is like the global environment and your environments like of function, then your super assignment go to global. which is dangerous. But if you have like instead of that, just an intermediary environment, I think that part make it more sense. A parent environment, I will say, not an intermediary. Like you have like, so you have global environment, you have parents and infants. And if your super assignment is an infant targeting parent, I feel it's safe. I will imagine it's a safer implementation than the one like with the just with global.
And that's kind of how R6 works, right? Is that R6 has its own little environment, and that's
it's global, why in global, it works. Hided in global, yeah.
Yeah.
And yeah. I'm just copy pasting that. I sorry for the link. I couldn't find a better link on push pop, but it's a common Linux function to move between directory, and it's a common also like programming stuff to manage a queue and stuff like that. So it's a common computer science. I'm not computer science, but I know it's a common computer science exercise where you're pushing and popping and go backwards. So computer science people are familiar with that, which not necessarily the case of our programmer.
Kind of like the hello world idea.
Yeah, it's similar. Yeah, I agree. But like I wanted to find the manual page of push and pop, but if you Google man push and man it's a bad
You get the trolley problem.
Yeah, there are plenty of stuff that's not related with what I wanted to get. Anyway, sorry to interrupt you.
I just wanted to add that, like, I thought that one of the reasons why this wouldn't work in S3 was exactly what you said, because of environment. Like, with S3, you will always get, you won't be able to modify the global variable, so then you cannot do the pop and change the state of the variable. So
okay, then the third key kind of difference here between R6 and S3 is method chaining. And that's like we talked about that before, right? The idea is with R6, you can chain, you can put functions basically back to back to back, just separated with a dollar sign, and that allows that to work. And nothing, I think, for the McGritter pipe, I don't think anything like that existed in the S3 kind of way of doing things. And so then the McGritter pipe kicked in, which allowed that method chaining, and now of course base R has its own pipe to allow that, so you can start to do it a bit now. It's just a little bit different, so it's kind of, I think, maybe one of these like solutions to help to take some of the pros of kind of an R6 type of environment and bring it into the S3 environment. Okay, so that was any other thoughts before, like, we move to S7. Any other questions or thoughts on S3, S4, R6?
I will say, I think it's fair if people are a bit disoriented. Like, because like, first, there's a lot. And second, like, you need to practice to get them. And so like, before doing anything like you have never done, it's fair that you are like not aware on how to do things. I will say, do not bother too much and try stuff, and if it fits the job, it fits the job. No,
yeah, I agree, because I would definitely admit like a lot of this was really tough for me to try to get, and I didn't fully get everything. But kind of where I got at the end of this is he really just needs to pull out the S4 and the R6 chapters and just focus on S3 and then get to S7, which we'll talk about now if folks are ready. But it really seemed like to me there was a lot of just like a lot of time spent on those two, where it seems like they're not really the ideal kind of way of doing things for most folks.
But we have like 2 decades of implementation of them, so you found them in package. So I think like the main point is like when you found them in package, you can just.
Fair enough. Yeah, and then I shouldn't also be as dismissive of S4, because bioconductor, like that's super important in bioconductor. I just don't have, that's just not part of my kind of worldview. But for folks who are, then obviously S4 is really critical. Yeah, good plan, Steffi. Okay, so then let's move on to S7, because that's one that you all probably didn't read too much about. So there's some cool things to think about. And I think everyone's probably, many of you maybe have seen this XKCD cartoon, which fits perfectly here, which is like, well, we have S4, S3, well, let's fix it with S4, right? And do these things we can't do. Oh, we can't, wait, that can't quite do what I need. So let's create R6, and then all of these different standards, different ways of doing things. But of course, every one of those, it's someone thinking that they're going to get a better way of doing it that's going to kind of usurp the other one and take, replace the other cases. But it's always just an additional new standard. And so that's kind of what S7 is trying to do again, which is to be the best of both worlds and combine the benefits of S3 and S4 in particular into one system that everybody can use, with the hope that it doesn't just become another system that that just adds to this, and that a small fraction of folks are going to use. There's nice references here to the documentation, so feel free, if you want to find out more about that, click this link here. And then Hadley introduced it to I guess it actually was RStudio Conf at the time. There, if you want to see his introduction to that. Okay, so what is it? So basically the idea is, it really is, it's called S7 because it's supposed to be S3 plus S4. It was originally called R7, but they changed it to S7 to make it be in this functional programming family, like S3, S4, S7, to separate it from R6, which is a different way of doing things. And the idea here is, it's supposed to be give you the nice features, the nice guardrails that don't exist in S3, without going to the far extremes of S4 and the kind of complications of using S4. It's supposed to be this nice kind of middle ground. It's also supposed to be highly compatible with S3, so you can use those interchangeably, or not interchangeably, but work with the kind of both directions, which is really nice, as opposed to the S4, which is just completely different than S3, which is really great. And there's a little vignette on compatibility for you can check out. And then, of course, it's part of, tidyverse is involved, so helpful error messages are critical there, as opposed to a lot of the unhelpful ones that we've got before. I should say, in case it wasn't, I don't think it was mentioned here, the group that's building S7, this is not just Hadley adding his additional standard there. This is a group that's built so that it's a consortium that's built out of R core, Tidyverse Posit, Bioconductor, R OpenSci, and some other groups. So it's really, the idea is supposed to bring everybody, all the stakeholders together, to design something that everybody can use and to really replace the existing kind of systems as much as possible. So that's, I think, good to know.
Can I ask you a question, Jeffrey?
Yeah.
Replace is an interesting word to me.
Yeah, that's probably not, it's probably too strong of a word. I don't think replace is the right word. But I think it would be the go-to one for folks kind of going forward.
So obviously, to make the software work, everything has to be backwards compatible. So S3 isn't going anywhere.
Right, right.
But
right.
What the idea would be is that all new programming would be done in S7.
I don't think it would say all new, because I think if you read just really simple things, you can do it in S3. But to be honest, the at least from my pretty brief overview of S7, the amount of additional work that you have to do is pretty minimal, but the gain that you get is pretty substantial. So
going from Markdown to Quarto.
I think that's a good
it looks exactly the same, and yet it's magically so much better.
Exactly. There's just this little bit extra you have to learn, but you can gain quite a bit more. Yeah, I think that's a good analogy.
So do you think that Hadley et al. Are rewriting the tidyverse in S7?
Well, certainly not. They're not right now until S7 becomes.
Sure.
So the idea, right? So right now, we'll see. S7 is a package that you have to load. The idea being that it's going to be in base R, right? But yeah. Well, so once it gets in base R, will they rewrite things in S7? That's a great question.
Okay. Thank you.
On the tidyverse, Tibble is the S3 is written in S3, no? I think because you have the data frame, and then Tibble is built on top of a data frame. It's a class. When you open the Tibble, it's a class Tibble, then data frame. So it's S3. So I don't know. It's a good question. Will Tibble will be a S7? We can ask him like if he do like a post. Usually like he came from like advanced R and ask question. So this is like definitely a question that I should like write somewhere and you can ask him.
Yeah, right. Keep, remember that one. Because that's, I mean, like, holy cow. Like having to rewrite an entire, like the entire tidyverse in S7, like that's a large scale
program. Yeah.
Well, except that like I rewrote all my class materials in Cordo by simply changing the extensions. So like it depends on what the task is for modifying an S3 object to an S7 object.
Yeah. No, you're
you
right.
Know, if all you have to do is change the extension, then yeah. You know.
And it's not that, but can you write a function that will automatically, you know, create these new classes? That's a good point. Cool. Good. All right, so let's see a little bit of what S7 looks like. So yeah, like I said, you're gonna need to install S7. It's on CRAN now. Last time when this was run, it was on GitHub, but at least it's on CRAN now, which is good. I'm gonna actually switch over to RStudio rather than just show it through the Quarto document there. So that's good. So we load our S7, and this is what it looks like. So we have a function called new class, right? Nice, you know, classic tidyverse things, right? Brilliant explanation, you know, brilliant naming here. So you create a new class called dog, and you have to, before we get to properties, you have to call the object that you're creating from this the same thing as the class, right? So that's what we're doing here. And then we have properties. So that, like, we had attributes in S3 and we had slots in S4. Well, in S7, they're called properties. So with properties, we can define this list of properties, one of which is called name and one of which is called age. One of the cool things that you'll notice maybe straight away is there's this thing called class character. And so this is, to me, really nice because it's basically like automatically building in at least the first levels of validation straight away. So as you assign this property name, you're already saying this should be of class character, age should be of class numeric. So that's really nice. And so now we just create this class and now we have a class called dog. And there's all the kind of things that we want, right? Thinking about parents, thinking about constructor functions, thinking about validator functions, and then those properties that we talked about there. So nice, just really simple things, but you automatically kind of build in some of the structure.
Does it use that slot notation?
It uses the properties notation.
I mean is the @. That's what I meant.
Yes. Same question. Yes. Good. Yeah. That's right. The at is the way of accessing properties,
yeah.
Which we'll
yeah,
see.
Okay.
Yeah. We'll see right there. Yep. Exactly. Okay. So here we're going to create an object called Lola of class dog. So we name it. The object is named Lola. The name is Lola. We give it an age. And then now we have an object that is of class dog with the property name Lola, the property age. 11. Yes, exactly. And this is how you both access, you get and set properties is by using that the at symbol there. So we can reassign our property age there. No problem. The cool thing is, like I mentioned before, because we built this, we use that class numeric. We can, it already assumes a particular class. So two things here. One is, like I said, we get that built-in validation already of it's expecting a numeric, not a character string. But then also we get a nice, like, understandable error message when we violate that. And that's kind of one of the key things I really want to do is focus on good error messages. Okay, so that's the objects, creating classes and objects. Now we can mess with the generics a little bit. We can create a new generic with the new generic function where we just say speak. And I believe, I forgot what this represents, but I believe this is basically whatever the variable is going to be down in the function, I think. I forgot now exactly what that second argument is here. So we're creating a new generic called speak, which we just did there. And then
method.
Now to create a new method, we use this function called method where we tell it the class and the object that it's a method for. So this is, I think, really nice way of just putting these things kind of together like that. And then we create our function, really straightforward. And now we can apply our generic speak to object Lola, which is class dog, right? And we get it to, it applies that method for speak dog and gives us woof. If we apply the method to the generic to a method that it does not have a class for, it gives us the a nice error. Can't find method for speak because the data frame, because I passed it a data frame.
So yeah, the class is data frame. The attribute is class attribute is data frame of empty cars.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Which is not necessarily like, yeah, you need to know what the class attribute is, but yeah.
And this is just another quick example. So now let's create another class called cat. We'll create another method for speak cat that says meow. Now we'll create an object Fluffy, speak to Fluffy, and we get meow. So that's just kind of showing how it works, which is nice, because I don't think actually in the book for S3, I did not think it did a good job of demonstrating how to actually set up generics and methods, at least the methods, right? It never showed an example of generic dot method, you know, function kind of thing. So how you would actually go about doing it, it just talked about it in the abstract. So this is how you would go about creating different methods for a particular generic. The cool thing about S7 generics is if you just call them by themselves, you get the methods that they include, which is really cool. So like if we could do this with print, we would just see all the different things that all the different, you know, print methods that are available. So that I think is really neat functionality of just calling the generics.
Okay, it's always a fight like with S3, no? To get all the...
Yeah, exactly. To get access. Yeah, I mean, right, they've written packages that, you know...
Yeah, to have that.
Packages that where you have functions to get all of this, but in this case, you just call the generic and you automatically get all of the methods, which is cool.
Yeah, sometimes finding out the extra options for generic functions is just like...
Yeah. Right, exactly. Right, because if you called this for an S3, you would just get the use method speak, right? That's all you get. Like, so unhelpful. What an unhelpful.
Yeah, usually you go straight to GitHub or where the code is stored, and just try to find where the piece of code is defined to understand what you can do. Not useful.
So really, really nice there. One of the cool things that you can do is, this gets back to the compatibility between S3 and S7. You can create a method print for cat, right? Print is an S3 generic function, but cat is our S7 class that we created, right? And then we can apply the method, the S7 method, to generate a method to print for cat, the cat class. And that works really nicely. So that's really cool. So that's part of that kind of compatibility.
Can you type print right now?
Yeah. Just print?
Just print? Yeah. Run that, yeah. I mean? No, just
method.
Just run that.
Sorry, I just did. What do you mean?
Yeah. No, I was just curious because you sort of made it into an S7 thing. Like, you know, on line 51, how you printed speak?
Mm-hmm.
And then you created this print thing, but print is like you said, it's generic.
It didn't change print, the generic print. It just created a method for print,
right,
for a new S7 class.
And so print as a generic stays an S3 object.
Exactly.
So I mean, print is a function.
But what's interesting, and what I was trying to do is, trying to figure out, well, how do I go back and find this, right? Like, you're right. Like, I had similar intuition, which is, I did something here, right? I created a method, but now how do I go find that method if I wanted to go to look it up, right, to see what this is? And that was actually really hard to do, because if you just do this, you know, if I just rerun this without the assignment, it doesn't work. If this were an S7 generic, this would work and it would show me the method, but it doesn't apply to S3 generics when you use them on an S7 class.
What if you type print.cat?
Yep, that doesn't
work.
Yeah, it doesn't work either. I don't know yet. I didn't spend a ton of time, but I don't know yet how to go back and figure out, unless there.
Isn't it like print.lm will give you the print?
Yeah.
Whatever.
Yeah. Because they're both S3. Well, I don't have.
No.
That at least will work.
I think that only works for like the help files, no?
Yeah, is that just for
help? Yeah, sorry. That's what you just said, yeah.
Yeah, huh, interesting.
So do question mark print cat.
Yeah, but there, I didn't create any help documentation.
Oh yeah, okay, okay, sure.
And, okay, just one question. Can you ask the structure of cat? I think you have done it previously, but yeah, structure is cat. Okay, and here we get all of the above. We get the, so it's the name. Cat, by the way, is a function also, so it's kind of tricky, no?
Oh, yeah.
Right, it was.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Can you look at the structure of Fluffy?
Yeah, okay. And it's see, that's like, fun. The top is cat.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, we can't access print cat.
So it's not creating this print dot, this print dot cat thing. Yeah. Is not a.
Oh, I don't know.
It interacts differently. So yeah, I don't know. This is something that there, I'm sure it probably in S7 there's a function that I can use that would return the method somehow, maybe. But
I think it's great to poke around and try, even if you do not have the answers. Like when you will get it, you will remember of trying to poke around, and it will complement like your question. It's always good to try to break stuff.
Yeah, exactly. So here's the help for that method, which it is specific, right? Retrieve a method for an S7 generic, right? Not for this kind of S3 generics that you're applying on an S7 class. And I don't know if method explain.
S3 class, maybe.
Let's try that.
I mean, the print is listed in the global environment as a function that you created. I'm not sure.
Yes, if that's function prints. It's true. It's appear like in your environment. Let's check. Like, do we have another example?
Wait, it must be an S. Look at that. It must be an S7 generic, not an S7 S3 generic. Like, it knows that print has now, you know, the ability to talk to S7 and S3 objects.
Mm-hmm.
That can just be, that's just a class. Generic. Huh. Okay. So yeah, there's still some, like, it's just kind of skimming the surface of S7, but there's cool. A lot of cool.
No, that's cool. Don't worry.
Do you know, or you may have mentioned this already, I might have missed it, what the sort of timeline for this being kind of ready?
No, that is a great question. And I have, I'm trying to think if I went.
That our studio comp talk was already 2 years old.
Yeah, it was. And it was, how do I move my, did it this way. Let's see.
It's not a major version. It's 0.1 something.
It's 0.11.
Yeah. So,
and that came out last September. A year ago is the last release, actually. But okay. it is being actively, you know, actively worked on.
It does say somewhat experimental down there, but
yes,
yeah,
it does. Actually, I was going to show that in a second.
This is so down. So we just move away from like the development version to a proper version, but still on the 0. Yeah. Something.
Right.
Well, the top one is actually, I think, the current version. I think the top news is like the news for the current development version. Current, if I understand. Right.
Yeah. I think that's
it doesn't have a version number yet.
Release. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So it definitely looks like active and not like ready.
Yeah, not ready. Definitely still in the experimental down here. And I didn't see, I couldn't find, I didn't spend a ton of time, but I didn't find anything with a timeline or anything like that.
I think I did see on CRAN that has one reverse dependency. So I think there is one package that uses it.
On CRAN,
yes, exactly. But I think I was also looking for R7 at the time, so I'm not sure if I...
Right.
Could we do just one more try on the method explain?
Yeah.
Because I see that it has like an argument called class. If you do print and then class cat.
Under
or fluffy. So
the generic is print.
Yeah. Uh-huh. The class is cats.
I don't know if that needs to be in quotes or not.
Try bus.
Yeah.
Oh, let's go like method explain print and the object fluffy. You need to add prints because then you will think fluffy is generic.
Oh, to do this, but change it to object.
Volume. No, not class object. Mm-hmm. Yeah, perfect. Sorry. It's hard to do that. Yep. That's a rabbit hole.
Yep.
Let's try method explain on speak instead of print.
And we need to provide speak and as a cat or fluffy. Yeah. Oh, cool. That's nice.
It doesn't give us wolf. I guess, right, because this is just giving us
the stack kind of.
Yeah.
And from there, you would know that it's using the dot. Well, no, I don't know. Never mind.
Okay.
Let's go back to the presentation. That's exciting. No, it's funny.
Yeah, it is. So the question is, do you switch to S7? And the answer is probably not yet, because it's still in development. As exciting, I started seeing this, and I have a project where I'm like, I want to start using generics. I'm like, oh, I want to use S7 because like this looks like such like the way to do it, but it's not quite ready yet, and it's not, like I said, not quite clear when that's going to be. But you can definitely download it, start messing around with stuff, get feedback, things like that. Maybe again, that's a question for Hadley. When's it going to be ready? Not quite there. The last thing is, this is actually a slide I put together that kind of brings, I think, all of these four things together and like a table that shows, I think, a nice comparison of this. We don't have to go through everything kind of stage by stage here, but hopefully this brings together a lot of things. This is that, Joe, this is getting at that question that you raised at the very, very beginning, the way they talk about it as a OOP, but functional, and then encapsulated. These are just links if you want to get to the packages for those two. Other things. This was actually a question I had. So question marks are things that I wasn't quite sure, so I didn't pull them in. Thinking about the namespace. So it's really clear that S3 is using a global namespace. I assume S4 and S7 would also, like, that's considered everything's happening in the global namespace because it's all generics happening at that same kind of level. So does that seem right?
Could be the namespace of the package, but does not change much. Like, let's say, like, in, let's say you have SF. SF is S3. If you print an SF object, which is also data frame, I think print is gonna go in base R, which is not global, it's base. I don't know.
Yeah, well, right now S7 is its own package, but the plan is to get it and fold it into base.
Yeah.
R when it's ready.
But then it's going to be in the base R namespace, not the global one, I think. Okay. I don't know. Good question. I don't know. Yeah,
I don't know. That, maybe I'll leave those as question marks.
Yeah. Well, that's fine.
For the next
people can correct it.
That's the next group can sort that out. Modify. Right. These are just some of those things. Also, we talked about modify in place. I guess similar with the kind of question, also I want to just double check. It was very clear that S3 uses you use basically a pipe for the method chaining. I assume that also would apply to S4 and S7 using pipes for method chaining.
Yeah. Right. I think it must. I think if it's so based on S3 and S4, it has to.
Yeah, basically, that's the only way to method chain.
I mean, what you could do is try it, right?
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Also, I just wanted to point out, I was looking at the repo again, and there's been a lot of activity this year, especially in just even in the last week or so. So that's nice to know. And it looks like the main contributor right now is Tomas Kalinowski from POSIT. So that's nice to know that it's definitely still being actively developed.
Good. Yeah. This gets at what we asked about, the kind of get set components. So now we're talking about these. So S7, sorry, just to remember, this is the S7 column. Uses that at symbol. And this I thought is maybe useful just to kind of compare, okay, how do you create a class? How do you validate generic method for all of the different things? And I've kind of put these together so you can see roughly how to do some of those things. And then what we call those additional components. So anyway, this might be a nice just reference. I got finger wagged from John, who said, like, you really need to make your slides are supposed to be slides, not like reference materials. I'm like, yeah, but like, what a great place to put a reference table for something like this, even though it's not a slide per se.
I think it's great. I think these are notes.
And especially for this chapter where it's really summarizing three chapters plus this brand new thing that we don't even have a chapter for, you know, keeping all of it. You know, I was just trying to keep it all in my head. I'm like, I just need to make a table out of all of this. So that's that.
Thanks a lot. It was great.
This was an awesome session. Really helped me a lot to, like, the last three have been, my brain is swirling a little bit. So thank you so much for pulling it all together.
Yeah, sure. I was pretty nervous about it when I signed up. I'm like, oh my gosh, I have to actually, like, that means I have to understand all three of those.
Exactly.
I can't like skip one and pretend I don't know.
The past 3 weeks, I've been very grateful that I didn't sign up for these ones.
Yeah. Cool. Well, great. Thanks a lot.
Yeah. So now we have a break for a week. Yeah. And then come back to hit the metaprogramming.
Yes.
Oh, that's right. I am not next week. Good. I was thinking I was next week, but on the week after. Good.
Yeah. So have a nice.